enable. PwC presents India Tax Talks in association with CNBC TV 18.
Tax laws and the technicalities surrounding it have a huge bearing on mergers and acquisitions. Hello and welcome to this series on PwC Presents India Tax Talks in association with CNBC TV 18. And I have experts who will be joining us to discuss exactly this. Hiten Kotak, partner M&A tax head at PwC. Omar Momin, head of M&A and business development at Godrej Consumer Products. Sanjay Jain, the group CFO of Future Group. And M.H. Qureshi, the head of tax in Asia Pac at Genpac. These are the gentlemen joining us to discuss this. Let me first take the question to a CFO. Sanjay, in deliberating on various aspects and strategies of the group, especially when it comes to any transaction, how much of a bearing does tax have? And how much of certainty do you allude to this particular aspect?
Well, tax has an important bearing in the decision making. I think as a business guy, when we are committing to any business case, the first thing we expect and we presume is predictability. And here we are fine with the fact that there is taxation is existing around the business case. There will be some tax lapse, there will be some tax outgo that is going to happen. But we make some assumption around it. We presume it is going to happen. But then let it be. You know, we can deal with it because it's built in the business case. But if things start changing 1 year down the line, 2 years down the line, you know, then it really impairs the business case, you know. And so that's the first simple thing I would expect, that give us predictability.
Right.
Second is it's one nation, you know, so one tax. I mean, GST has been one such step. But when it comes to taxation, stamp duties, for example, you know, registration duties, why have it different treatment across various states, you know? Just allow us to be dealing with just one rate across the states, you know.
Right.
And then likewise, you know, governance, simplicity is what all that we aspire for and we all should be doing. But when we are trying to simplify the legal structures, when we're trying to merge two into one, no parent, no subsidiary, just one company, then don't tax us on such transactions in terms of stamp duties, registration fees, etc. We are trying to aim for simplicity. We're trying to aim for transparency. Why should be a taxation cost in this, you know?
Right.
So I believe these are few simple things. If you allow us to, you know, be working in such an environment, I think we are committed to create value for all stakeholders.
That's a wish list for every CFO, and you have articulated it well, Sanjay. But let me move across to another global company then, and Harun joins us from Genpac. Harun, help us understand, you know, the two important words that everybody speaks about when it comes to taxability is certainty as well as simplicity. It's not just the Indian CFOs, but also the investors coming from overseas. You being a global company, how do you see the Indian tax culture versus some of the other developed worlds, and how much do we need to improve on that?
I think basically over the last few years, I think the global tax scenario has changed a lot. There have been certain very fast-paced developments, and India in a way has been a pioneer in many of those. For example, the whole BEPS initiatives came up over the last 2 years, and I think the world is moving towards source-based taxation, which India has always been a champion of. The other thing which is happening is there's a lot of focus on anti-avoidance. So if you look at the whole thrust of BEPS initiatives, there's a lot of discussions around anti-avoidance, treaty shopping. There's a lot of, and then there are countries who are, in addition to BEPS, there are countries who are going in their own way independently and trying to implement things on anti-avoidance, which are over and above the agreed BEPS structures. So I think that is one struggle which now corporates face globally, that the same pie of income may be sought to be taxed twice in two different countries. So I think that is something that we'll have to reckon with as we go ahead. The other thing which is happening is there's a lot of focus on digital tax, on digitization per se of the tax processes. Every country, every group of countries, whether it's EU, whether it's India, Australia, everyone is coming out with their own version of digital tax. So I think that is something which will be under a lot of focus, and India is also catching up on that with the whole thing in the last budget on the significant economic presence. So India is very much in line with that.
Let me go straight across to the M&A transactions and the tax implications on that. The one particular aspect which has been really driving the mergers and acquisitions space in the last couple of years is definitely coming in from the stressed asset space, and especially the insolvency and bankruptcy code. Let me throw this question to Hiten from PwC. Hiten, how has IBC really changed the entire landscape? And more than that, are these policies, when they come into play, are they aligning with the tax laws as well?
See, the IBC law has clearly laid down a very clear path on how the stressed assets would be taken care. Earlier, as we knew, bank used to take years and years to recover their dues, or these assets were remaining idle, unused because of lack of funding, etc., etc. Whereas this law now clearly lays down how will the lenders really deal with the situations and assets. Whereas, the law has laid down a strict timeline in a sense, we have seen that since the law is still getting developed, those timelines are not getting followed. And there is a lot of litigation around various provisions of the Act, Section 29A, to what extent and what level the current promoters can participate, or, say, provision of 12A, as to at what stage, the NCLT proceedings can be withdrawn. So one good thing would be clarify the law, as we learn from the experiences, rather than wait for the judiciary to settle down the law. That will clearly further help the intent of the IBC provisions. As far as the alignment of, if we take the specific example of therefore insolvency law with the other laws, it has been an issue.
Right.
Initially, we used to struggle with the SEBI provisions or the, takeover code provisions or preferential issue guidelines for any preferential allotment to be done to the acquirer, etc. It took almost a year for SEBI to amend the provisions. Mm-hmm. Luckily, now we are through with all the appropriate amendments put in place. And therefore, that one law is now clarified and is totally aligned, I would say, with the insolvency law. Hmm. A lot was expected, therefore, from the income tax law also, or Income Tax Act also. Hmm. Small amendments here and there have happened, but there are still, I would say, 2-3 significant provisions which are clearly coming in the way of a simplified, takeover kind of a position. And two things which I would like to mention here is, one is the provisions of Section 56.210. Where if the value of shares as prescribed under the Income Tax Act is higher than the transaction value.
Right.
In most IBC cases, the transaction value for the shares is almost zero.
Yes.
Because there is no value left for equity shareholders at all, in a sense. However, if the 56.210 value, which is the prescribed value as per the Income Tax Act, which in a listed company depends on the market price and an unlisted company on the balance sheet position, if that is higher than the transaction value, then there can be a taxation on the acquirer and also on the seller, in a sense.
Right.
So, which is really causing a lot of problem in the smooth takeover of such companies. Mm-hmm. And unnecessary structuring then has to be done to avoid this, anomaly kind of.
Right.
Similar is the position of minimum alternate tax.
Right.
Any such takeover or any such resolution of, bad asset would entail a lot of write-offs by the banks. Those write-offs, when they are reflected in the books of the company, the corporate debtor, will result in a book profit.
Hmm.
That would amount to paying minimum alternate tax if this shelter available is not sufficient. This is again causing a lot of stress. Because you can't have a provision for large tax payments in your cash flow when you are acquiring such bad assets into inventory.
Omar, talking from the M&A expert point of view, how much more needs to be evolved in IBC to make it a smooth process? We have seen over the years a lot of matters going to the courts and then evolving. A lot of these rules have changed completely. But how much more to do?
So I think the first thing that's very clear is the resolution of stressed assets as a process has been streamlined tremendously by the IBC. And I think towards that objective, while timelines have been defined and they're much before, they're much better than they used to be before, as Hiten said, I think a much better focus on how do we simplify and ensure that these timelines are met, not just by the authorities within the IBC space, but also related regulators. Mm. How do we ensure that there is an understanding and a coordination so that the entire process works smoothly and tries to establish adherence to this timeline would be very material and important going forward. I think the other thing would be as the number of cases under the IBC increase and we see success as we have over the last year, the capacity of the authorities, the NCLT, the NCLAT will need to be increased in terms of the benches, etc. And I think both of these would ensure that we have not just adherence to timelines, but also a much higher recovery rate in terms of cents on the dollar that we can have as a system than we used to have before.
PwC presents India Tax Talks in association with CNBC TV 18.
Hiten, come in on this particular bit. Let me focus on one important issue, angel tax. How grave is the issue and is there any sanity now with some notifications coming in? But what we hear is that there is no respite despite the DPPIT notice.
Yeah, because you know the entire issue of angel taxation has really, in a sense, questioned the entire initiative of startups like I've been. Because, you know, startups, if they were to be valued into inverted so scientifically, they would be zero value to almost all the startups. And therefore, the entire equity brought into the such startups would really become income, like I've been. And, you know, this provision of 56.27B really was a surprise to many of traditional tax consultants like us, where the equity is becoming income, kind of like I've been. In spite of the fact that the sources of the equity can be appropriately explained. So, you know, while this notification, recent notification, has, in a sense, reduced the burden, I would say, to some extent, but still, you know, the cap of 25 crores, which is put on, you know, the unquestioned capital, whether that is sufficient or not, how easy it is or to get the registration with the relevant authority and ultimately with CBDT is also a huge question mark. Like, I mean, and the startups have been given tax exemption under 8IIAC, which is a good thing. But the bad thing is that there is no exemption from minimum alternate tax. So while they are not liable to pay tax at, say, 25%, they would end up paying, you know, or getting out of cash to the extent of the minimum alternate tax. So that is, again, an anomaly which has been left open, kind of, like I've been. These are the small, you know, issues which really keep bothering people.
Yes.
And therefore, the angel taxation, in spite of, as you rightly said, the recent notification, the issues are not totally out of, you know, place and totally taken care, kind of like.
So, Omar, how much of the transactions are really impacted by these uncertainties and, case in point, the angel tax issue?
So, I think there is one, the perspective of acquirers or investors in terms of smoothening up the process of providing capital and scaling up startups. But I think the more important issue is from the perspective of the ecosystem that we want to create as a country itself, which is to encourage entrepreneurship, to encourage a million startups blooming in every way possible. And I think entrepreneurs would like to spend their time managing their business rather than managing tax notices. And I think just creating a certain space specifically to provide entrepreneurship to bloom would go a huge way in building that culture. And of course, then from the acquirer perspective, you will have much greater access to capital, much greater efficiency, and an ecosystem that just builds onto a virtuous cycle.
Hiten, throw more light. A lot of clarity is needed on many aspects, like the Supreme Court verdict on Smith Securities was an important one in claiming goodwill depreciation. Now, we recently had a deal in consumption space where the goodwill is being questioned, right? So many such questions really get raised, and there is a little bit of ambiguity in all of them, even taxability of deferred consideration. Can you throw more light on the various aspects?
So goodwill is a very important aspect in any M&A decision itself. Like, I mean, so if, as you rightly said, in a consumption space, the value I'm paying for is largely for goodwill. Whether I will get a tax break on that goodwill going forward or not will determine the value that I'm putting on the asset, like I've been. So that certainty clearly is very important to any transaction. So if we go back in 1998, the Section 32 of the Income Tax Act was amended to really allow depreciation on what we call as intangible assets. Thereafter, we took so many years. Ultimately, Smith Securities, in some sense, has put an end to the controversy whether this amendment to Section 32 would be applicable on acquisition of goodwill pursuant to any transaction.
Right.
I think Smith Securities, at least to some extent, resolves the issue of whether goodwill as an intangible asset is eligible to depreciation or not.
Right.
So that uncertainty prevailed for so many years, like I've been. And, you know, the litigations were on, there were contradictory decisions of the various courts, etc., etc. Supreme Court, you know, it seems has at least settled down whether goodwill is entitled to depreciation or not. However, the other question which this judgment has raised, that in an amalgamation, say an acquisition through an amalgamation process, which is otherwise tax neutral, is goodwill getting created pursuant to such process is entitled to depreciation or not? And you know, being a Supreme Court judgment, of course, you know, one viewpoint is that it's ultimately the law of the land.
Sanjay, apart from the various other tax tangles, the very fact that the cost of transaction in India, the stamp duty registration, that also is on the higher side. That is also a matter of concern. How will you rate that?
I think on a 10-point scale, I think 10 being very severe and, you know, 0 being a utopia kind of situation, I would say India is about, I think, somewhere 6 to 7.
Okay.
I think in many of the developed part of the world, the duties are far lower. In India, stamp duties hover between 5 to 7, say, for example, for a real estate or so. But when you go to Singapore, the duties go very, very high. Why are stamp duties there? A, the state governments tend to use this as a revenue collection for development objectives, you know. But at the same time, this country has a very big social aspiration of housing for everyone.
Right.
So don't you think there is a case for actually lowering the duty down over
right.
there? Just consider hypothetically, it is brought down to 2 to 3%. Yeah. There should be a mushrooming of housing construction, house buying.
Right.
The volumes would far outweigh for a state government the benefit that a 6, 7% may give. I mean, thankfully, we are coming out of GST being imposed on the construction, you know, housing, which is still under construction. On top of that, your stamp duties as well. So there is a case, there is a merit in bringing it down. Allow us to pass through a phase of developing to having arrived in life. Then probably you can talk about, you know, high duties or so. For now, the need of the hour is lower duty, you know, more activity, more business activity, then I think state government, I'm not touching the topic of one unified tax for a moment, but for a given state government as well, kindly allow the activity to be broad-based, then your revenue collection will be far more and actually through a higher tax.
All right, so let me take it to Haroon. And quickly, Haroon, India needs tax consolidation like the Western world.
India is part of the global world now. And I would certainly think a globalized India does need some form of group taxation. Now, there are several countries who have tried this and very successfully. For example, US, UK, Australia, France, Japan, they all have different kinds of group taxation. For example, US allows just a single return to be filed, whereas UK, it is more limited. They basically allow the losses to be set off against profits of other group companies. And India can obviously, to start with, India can do it on a pilot basis and not basically follow the US model, perhaps in the interim follow the UK model. But I think some form of group taxation, I think it is high time we should look at. There is so much focus on the ease of doing business scores, which have significantly improved over the last few years. I think with the group taxation coming in some form, we can clearly expect great easing of the administrative burden, which taxpayers and even the tax department faces. And I think that would go a long way in further boosting our ease of doing business and reducing litigation and the uncertainty that we were talking about.
Yes, that's a very important point. And taking it to Hiten, the another important bit that tax consolidation can really bring about is help the group restructuring exemptions as well.
Absolutely. So the entire concept of tax deferment, if there is no encashment as a group, like I've been, if there is no encashment event as a group, which is acknowledged in US, UK, would go, be a lot helpful in really creating the right structures to generate the right value and help encashment at an appropriate time. So that entire concept of tax deferment till the right moment, if this group consolidation is brought in, would really help in a sense. Both really, I would say, go hand in hand. The group consolidation for taxation and the exemptions related to group restructuring, in some sense, go hand in hand. But clearly, these provisions exempting internal restructuring, would definitely help create right structures and create right value.
All right. Clarion call from the entire panel coming in for predictability, certainty and simplification. Hope digitization of taxation also helps in that. And tax is not as taxing when it comes to transactions and mergers and acquisitions. With that, thanks to all our panel of experts for sharing their thoughts and their expertise. And with that, it's a wrap on this edition. Thanks so much for tuning in to CNBC TV 18.
PwC presents India Tax Talks in association with CNBC TV 18. Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.